Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our morning service on this very special Advent Sunday. It's lovely to see you. Thank you so much for being with us. Let's just quiet our hearts for a moment and then we'll begin. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and also with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And so now we come to our introductory prayer. Let's say this together. We've come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Well, now, as it is Advent and Advent Sunday, we're going to start our service this morning by lighting some Advent candles.
If ever there was a year we needed Advent, this is the year. We hardly know how to describe the year we have lived through. We hesitate to reflect on all the mess around us in 2020. All we know is that nothing seems right, nothing seems like it used to be, nothing. We need Advent.
The prophet Isaiah cried out for us, "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down to make your name known, so that the nations might tremble at your presence." So tear through the mess, O Lord, and come down to us again. We long to be your people, a people of hope.
We light this first candle as a sign of our hope, hope that you can meet us even in the mess of our world. Hope that you still see us, though we feel we are lost in the rubble. Let this light be the guide that brings us to Emmanuel once more. We say together,
O come, Emmanuel.
So now we're going to sing together our very first hymn. It's "Lo, He Comes with Clouds Descending."
Thank you.
And so now we come to a time of confession. Would you please join in with the responses? When the Lord comes, he will bring to light things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Therefore, in that light, we confess our sins. Turn to us again, O God, our Saviour, and let your anger cease from us. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Your salvation is near for those that fear you, that glory may dwell in our land. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And we say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So now we have a special prayer of thanksgiving for this Advent season. Blessed are you, Sovereign God, ruler and judge of all. To you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of this age that is passing away, may the light of your presence, which the saints enjoy, surround our steps as we journey on. May we reflect your glory this day, and so be made ready to see your face in the heavenly city where night shall be no more. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. And now Andy White is going to lead us in our reading. He's going to be reading from Mark's Gospel, chapter 13, verses 24 to 37.
Our reading is taken from the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 13, verses 24 to 37. But in those days, following that distress, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, men will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that it is near, right at the door. I tell you this truth, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Be alert. You do not know when that time will come. It is like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with his assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight, or when the cock crows or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone. Watch. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So now Michael Paddison is going to bring God's word to us.
Let us pray. Lord, take my mind now and think through me. Take my heart and love through me. Take my lips and speak through me your words to teach and touch our hearts, that we may glorify you in our lives, for our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Our reading today was the second half of Mark chapter 13. And it began, "But in those days, following that distress," which instantly raises two questions. Which days and what distress? Well, to find out, we need to look at the first half of Mark chapter 13. Jesus and his disciples were leaving the temple when one of his disciples remarked on its massive stones. And it was indeed a very large and extremely beautiful building, possibly the most beautiful for several hundred miles around. And some of its stones measured 30 feet in length. "You see all this?" asked Jesus. "It will all be thrown down. Not one stone will be left upon another." No wonder his disciples were astonished. It must have seemed such a stable building, this great symbol of God's presence. After crossing the Kidron Valley over to the Mount of Olives, opposite the temple, Peter, James, John and Andrew asked him, "Lord, when will this happen? What will be the sign that it's about to be fulfilled?" Jesus answered by warning them not to be taken in by false teachers and false Christs, not to be alarmed by earthquakes, wars and famines, and not to be tripped up by ferocious persecution and hatred. Subsequent events, sadly, have proved how necessary Jesus' warnings were. And then the whole mood of his warning changes. "When you see Jerusalem threatened by a heathen army, run for it," he said. "Take to your heels, leave everything and flee." Now, we know that this happened in AD 67 to 70. The Christians escaped to Pella as the Romans approached Jerusalem. The Romans besieged Jerusalem. Conditions within the city were apparently and unbelievably appalling. The Romans eventually broke through the wall and they utterly destroyed the temple. Indeed, subsequent archaeology has uncovered massive stones just strewn randomly around the base of where the temple stood. And that is the distress referred to at the beginning of today's reading. But today is Advent Sunday, the church's New Year's Day. Happy New Year. So what has the destruction of the temple to do with Advent? Well, please bear with me. Advent basically means coming. And over the next 4 weeks, we prepare to remember the birth of Jesus Christ, the incarnation, God's taking of human flesh and becoming a man, and why he did so. But in Advent, we are also reminded of the promised second coming of Jesus Christ at the end of the age. And in Mark chapter 13, Jesus has deliberately woven the destruction of the temple and his second coming together. The destruction of the temple prefiguring his second coming. Reasons for this? Well, verses 19 and 20, Jesus' language is too emphatic, especially verse 20, to apply only to the destruction of the temple. And in verse 26, "At that time they will see." It implies that the generation whom Jesus is addressing now won't be alive to see it. And he speaks of the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Didn't happen in AD 70. And then verse 27, "And he will send his angels to gather his elect." That didn't happen in AD 70 either. It also implies that preaching the gospel to all nations will have happened by then. And then in verse 30, "This generation will not pass away before," and then he goes on, the Greek word genea is translated generation. In other words, the temple would be destroyed within the lifetime of the generation then living. But genea can equally refer to the Jewish nation, that it will still be there at Jesus' second coming. Both meanings are equally plausible. Jesus was indeed speaking of both events. So, what can we do about this? How does it affect us? Well, the temple was destroyed about 1950 years ago. So when is Jesus coming back? Jesus replies, "No one knows about that day or that hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." Well, that should warn anyone against pursuing the science of numbers to try to calculate the date of Christ's return. For instance, the Jehovah's Witnesses and others. It's sheer presumption to try, and if we do, we shall infallibly be proved to be wrong. Can you imagine what the world would have been like if we did know? Jesus immediately followed this up with, "Be on guard, be alert," in other words, now. You do not know when that time will come. And if you don't know when he will return, but you know it could be tomorrow, or it could be in 1,000 years' time, you will be, or should be, constantly preparing yourself, examining yourself, aware that although we are created in God's image, yet we are fallen beings, we are full of sin, and God is so other from us. It's truly a blessing that we don't know when he's coming, because it keeps us on our toes. "It's like a man going away," said Jesus. "He leaves his house and puts his servant in charge, each with his assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Today we have locks and keys, and possibly even a burglar alarm to secure our houses. And yet, many modern apartment buildings employ a full-time guard at the entrance, and he sees all who comes and goes. And it's essential, therefore, that he doesn't doze off, and so with the doorkeeper in the parable. Therefore, said Jesus, keep watch, you disciples. Keep watch, Christians all around the world. Keep watch, you and me. Because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back. It could be at any time during the day, or it could be at any time during the night. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you asleep." Now, what I'm about to say may seem as though I'm going off at a tangent, but I'm not. When Jesus says, "No one knows, only the Father," he's using the language of Hebrew marriage. Now that shouldn't surprise us. We've all heard of the church described as the bride of Christ. We've all heard of the marriage of the Lamb in the book of Revelation. Once a Hebrew couple were betrothed, which means that in effect they were married, but had not yet consummated that marriage, they separated for quite a long time, possibly a year, possibly even more. The bridegroom went back to his father's house to prepare a home for his bride. The bride was to be prepared for her marriage and all that that implied. Only when the father was satisfied with the son's preparations would he let the son go to claim his bride for the marriage ceremony. Hence, only the Father knew. And in that respect, we need to remember Jesus' parable of the 10 virgins awaiting the bridegroom's arrival to claim his bride. The five wise girls had spare oil. The five foolish girls didn't. They all became drowsy and they fell asleep. You remember what happened when the bridegroom arrived. The wise girls went with him and they went into the wedding banquet. The foolish, unprepared girls had been buying oil, and so they were late, and the door had been shut. And they knocked on the door and said, "Sir, sir, open the door, let us in." And the bridegroom said, "I don't even know you." Jesus concluded that parable with, "Keep watch, for you do not know the day or the hour." Now this raises one last big question. For what are we to keep watch? Jesus said, "Learn from the fig tree. When it begins to come into leaf, you know that summer is near." "Even so," he continued, "when you see these things happening," well, these things basically are what we looked at earlier, false teachers, false Christs, and people deceived, wars and earthquakes and famines, hatred and increasing persecution, families or family members even betraying each other, and an army gathering for an assault on Jerusalem. All these have happened, are happening, will happen, presumably with increasing frequency and in increasing severity. We don't know the day or the hour, but we will know that he is near. So watch the news, international news as well as national news. Be aware of what's going on. Don't be unprepared. And I leave you with Jesus' concluding words in today's reading. What I say to you, I say to everyone. Watch. Amen.
Our next hymn is a lovely prayerful one. It's called Faithful One. So now let us declare together our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. May Almighty God strengthen this faith in us. So now we have our special prayer, our collect prayer, for the first Sunday of Advent. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armour of light, now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to us in great humility, that on the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal, through him who is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. And now John Barley is going to lead us in our prayers and intercessions, and he'll conclude with the words of the Lord's Prayer.
Shall we pray together? Father, may this season of Advent renew our hope and the trust which we place in the future that you have prepared for us. May our hope be strong in the face of all that makes for despair, fear, and unbelief. The cruelties that people inflict on one another, the questions that cannot be answered, the uncertainty of our tomorrows. May our trust grow stronger, Father, as we celebrate the coming of Christ in glory. When pain and suffering, parting and death will come to an end, wars shall cease, hunger be no more, and everyone lives secure in your eternal love. Father, forgive all within us that is unprepared for Christ's coming, our neglect of other people's need, our involvement in what is trivial, and our indifferences to what is of lasting importance in our lives. Our idleness in prayer and lack of attention to your word. Make us ready for his coming, that we may run to meet him with love, adoration, and gratitude. Father, as the pandemic continues to course through our world, we ask you to bring comfort and healing to those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. Comfort the lonely and the bereaved. Be by the side of those with uncertain futures and spread your calm among us. Lord, we pray that you will give our leaders wisdom to act justly and fairly for all people. We pray especially for the incoming President of the United States of America. May he feel your guiding hand as he tries to heal a divided nation. Amen. We pray again, Lord, for those trapped in war zones. Bring peace and reason, Lord, we pray. Lord God, Christmas will soon be amongst us. It will be very different this year for many of us. Comfort those who will find themselves alone for the first time, for those who choose caution over family reunions, and for those who are told to self-isolate. May we focus all the more on the real meaning of Christmas. May we marvel at your wondrous gift given to humankind. Father, we are told to watch for Christ's coming again in power and glory. But may we always be receptive to his continuing coming into our everyday lives. And may we live those lives to your glory. And so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our final hymn this morning on this Advent Sunday is Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. So now we come to our closing prayer and blessing. Almighty God, as your kingdom dawns, turn us from the darkness of sin to the light of holiness, that we may be ready to meet you in our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So now we say together the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen. May God give to you and to all those whom you love his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all those you love this day and always. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you. That really does bring our service to a close once again for another week. Now, we look forward to seeing you again next week. We'll certainly be here online, so please look out for that link on YouTube and share it with your family and friends. Now, we are able to meet in church again next week, being December the 6th, so there will be a service here at Necton at 10 o'clock in the morning, but also at St. Andrew's Home Hell at 11:15. Necton at 10, Home Hell at 11:15, so please join us if you can. If not, find us here online. So now, just one final notice, if I may. We are, of course, moving through Advent into Christmas, and already people are beginning to decorate their houses. But at the same time, it's been a very difficult year for some. And so I'd like us to shine a little bit of light and a little bit of encouragement into our communities. And I'd like to therefore suggest and encourage you to put a candle arch in your window this Christmas, you know, so it shines out for all to see. Candle arches are, in a funny sort of way, reflective of the menorah, the ancient candelabra that used to shine in the temple in Jerusalem. That never went out because it was always a sign of God's presence. Yahweh was there in the temple. And I'd like something of that to be reflected in our message to our communities, that God is still with us, and he still cares, and he loves us regardless of what the year may have been like and what the future may be like. He's still there. So please put a candle arch in your window and let it be a sign of God's presence, a sign of God's love, a sign of God's hope, and a prayer for our communities, a sign of his blessing. And with that in mind, thank you so much for being with us. Take care, look after yourselves, goodbye, and God bless.